Now to those stunning images of horror and mayhem captured during deadly terror attacks this week. In Canada, shots fired at a national war memorial and Parliament killing a soldier. And in New York City, a hatchet attack on police officers. Both incidents carried out by so-called lone wolves. And there are new fears this morning about how many more are out there. Dan Harris has been tracking the story all week.
It took only 7 seconds, but it was devastating. A hatchet attack by this man against 4 New York City police officers, one of them hit in the head before the suspect was shot and killed. Zale Thompson, a 32-year-old unemployed recent Muslim convert who police say was self-radicalized on the internet watching videos of ISIS and Al-Qaeda.
I'm very comfortable this was a terrorist attack, certainly.
It came just a day after that deadly rampage in the Canadian capital when another 32-year-old Muslim convert put the city of Ottawa on lockdown. After allegedly killing a soldier who was guarding Canada's National War Memorial, Michael Zahaf Bibo stormed the Parliament building as bystanders fled.
Shots were fired, and that's when the gunman started running, again, with bullets flying at him, directly down this hallway. This is the incredible part. He then ran past these two rooms, which were filled with members of Parliament. And in fact, in this room was the Prime Minister himself.
He was stopped by Sergeant-at-Arms Kevin Vickers, seen here just moments after he shot and killed the suspect. Zahaf Bibo, unemployed with a long criminal record, was reportedly frustrated over delays in getting a passport to travel to the Middle East. The attack, part of a worrying worldwide trend. After ISIS put out an online call for attacks against Western targets, homegrown extremists have been either killed during their attacks or arrested beforehand in America, Canada, England, and Australia.
Terror is theater, and obviously they're trying to create and instill fear. And unfortunately, I think we're going to see more of it.
For this week, Dan Harris, ABC News, New York.
Thanks to Dan. More on this now from the chair of the House Committee on Homeland Security, Congressman Michael McCaul, and Matthew Olson, who was the director of the National Counterterrorism Center until just last month. I would like to start with you, Congressman McCaul. Do you consider the attack in the New York City subway a terror attack?
I do. I think all the markings are there of radical Islamist ties. This is the profile of the enemy within self-radicalization within the United States. We worry a lot about ISIS traveling overseas from Syria to the United States, but I think one of the greatest fears are those already within the United States who are being radicalized and inspired by the ISIS propaganda that's out there on the internet. They are waging a campaign of war against the West and the United States, and these are three examples just last week of where they're winning.
One of the things that struck me, and particularly this week with a school shooting, is worried about copycats and that people are inspired not just by ISIS, but by seeing these other attacks. Congressman, quickly on that, and then I want to go to Matt Olson on that as well.
Well, I think, you know, getting attention. In a lot of cases, these are people in a basement radicalizing over the internet. They're not mentally all that sound in a lot of cases. And they're very hard to stop. That's the main point I want to make, is to detect and deter and disrupt these cases, as FBI Comey director said before my committee, are really one of the most difficult to stop. And it's like finding a needle in a haystack and then getting them out of that radicalization towards a de-radicalization path.
And Matt Olson, again, on the fears of this copycat, but is there a strategy to stop this?
You know, I agree with Chairman McCaul. These are very difficult to stop. I mean, this is the kind of violence that we've been concerned about, this spate of violence over the last week. We need to learn more about the motivation for each of these. Obviously, each one is under investigation. But again, this is the kind of violence from these homegrown extremists that we've been concerned about over several years. This is not, you know, this is not a new phenomenon. The propaganda we see from ISIS does give us additional concern, because they're very good at putting out their message online and seeking to, you know, have their supporters carry out attacks wherever they are. And as Chairman McCaul said, it's very hard for local law enforcement or the intelligence community to stop these single individuals who are seeking to carry out these small-scale attacks like we've seen over the past week.
Let's go back to the attack in Canada. Canadian officials say the shooter was upset because he couldn't get a passport to Syria or Libya. Would things have been different in the United States? Would we have been able to track him in a different way? Matt Olson?
Yeah, it's hard to say exactly if things would have been different. But I think this case highlights that in Canada, look, we work really closely with our Canadian counterparts as well as with law enforcement and services around Europe and around the world. What this highlights is the need to have really good information sharing. So if we have somebody that we see who we're concerned about, we need to make sure that other countries have that information as well. And the other thing is we need to make sure that information that we get on the intelligence side is shared with law enforcement. That's one of the things that we worked on at the National Counterterrorism Center, really crossing that intelligence and law enforcement divide to make sure that the FBI and in particular local police departments have the information they need to identify these individuals and stop them before they're able to carry out an attack like this.
And Congressman McCaul, your colleague, Congressman Peter King, said this week, we need to be more closely watching Muslim communities in the U.S. and go all out with surveillance and be quick to call it terrorism. Do you agree with him that these communities should be under surveillance?
Well, I was a federal prosecutor like Matt, worked on FISAs. And look, yeah, surveillance of mosques is a very sensitive issue. But what I would urge would be that we have greater community involvement within the mosques. Remember Tamerlan Tsarnaev, the Boston bomber, got literally kicked out of his mosque. And yet there was no reporting of that at the time. And had there been, just maybe we could have stopped that particular bombing from happening. And it's very true of a lot of these cases where they do attend mosques. There is radical behavior. And I think it's more of the FBI and Homeland Security working with state and locals within the Muslim community.
And those local law enforcement really have to come into play there, it seems like. Thank you very much to both of you.